In this Q&A video, we'll be considering the question, can I use steel conduit as the CPC or the earth in a circuit? The first thing to suggest in this video is that we know the difference between an earth and a CPC or circuit protective conductor. However, if we didn't include the word earth in the title of the video, no one would watch it. Now, this content relates to the recent review that Gary and Gordon made on the MetPro Conlok system. So if you're interested in a quicker and easier way to install steel conduit, then please do go and watch that video after this one, of course. Everything that we're about to discuss applies equally to threaded conduit connections and the Conlok grub screw system, because that system has been tested to meet the relevant requirements for earth continuity. So, can we use metal conduit as the CPC in a circuit? Well, the simple answer is yes, providing you meet certain requirements. Make sure you stay on to the end of the video for the last piece of the puzzle in this process. So let's look at the conditions that allow us to use steel conduit as a CPC. We find the first part of the answer in regulation 543.2.1 in BS 7671, where we find a list of items that can be acceptably used as a protective conductor. And sixth on the list, we find that we can use a metal conduit, metallic cable management system, or other enclosure or electrically continuous support system for conductors. So if we stopped reading there, we'd have our answer. So why don't we stop there? Well, that list also says that we can use a single core cable as the CPC, but we know that installing a 1mm squared conductor as the CPC for a 150mm three-phase submain probably won't cut it. So let's keep digging. There's more detail further down the page in regulation 543.2.5, which reads, the metal covering, including the sheath, bare or insulated of a cable, in particular the sheath of a mineral insulated cable, trunking and ducting for electrical purposes, and metal conduit, may be used as a protective conductor for the associated circuit if it satisfies both requirements of items 1 and 2 of regulation 543.2.2. So there's some requirements that we need to meet in regulation 543.2.2 in order to be able to use the steel conduit for our CPC. However, it's only the first two items in that reg. Let's read those now. Where a metal enclosure or frame of a low voltage switchgear or control gear assembly or busbar trunking system is used as a protective conductor, it shall satisfy the following three requirements. Its electrical continuity shall be assured either by construction or by suitable connection in such a way as to be protected against mechanical, chemical, or electrochemical deterioration. So this part is saying that you really need to make sure that all the connections between your pieces of conduit and accessories like boxes and socket outlets are properly made, as the system will rely on those for both a mechanical and an electrical connection. The second part of that reg is really interesting and is what we're going to focus on for a few moments now. 2. Its cross-sectional area shall be at least equal to that resulting from the application of regulation 543.1 or verified by test in accordance with the appropriate part of BSEN 61439 series. So, if the conduit system is put together properly and tightly with the right accessories, we should be able to meet the first item easily enough. But what about that second item? Have you ever thought about the cross-sectional area of steel conduit? Let's do it now. Regulation 543.1, which is just one page back in the regs, discusses the cross-sectional areas of protective conductors and starts in 543.1.1 by giving us two options for making sure the CSA of the steel conduit is the right size. First, we can calculate using regulation 543.1.3, which if we glance down the page involves using what's generally referred to as the adiabatic equation, which is not as scary as it looks. It's just a way of figuring out what size your protective conductor should be using the actual conditions it will experience when a fault occurs, but it can be a bit more long-winded, so we'll cover that in a future video. The second option is to use regulation 543.1.4, which is what we're going to do. Just a quick note before we do that though, just after outlining these two options, the following paragraph points out that if we've selected the CSA of our line conductors to make sure they can cope with the expected short circuit current, and we expect the earth fault current to be lower, then we do need to use the adiabatic method. However, generally speaking, we size our line conductors to make sure they can cope with either the design or nominal current in the circumstances they're installed in, and sometimes we may beef them up a bit to reduce volt drop, but only occasionally do we size them to make sure the cable can cope with short circuit current, because if all the other conditions for sizing a cable are met, then it should be okay. One other thing to think about is if you're running a couple of circuits through the conduit, say one for lighting and one for power, then regulation 543.1.2 comes into effect. This states, Where a protective conductor is common to two or more circuits, its cross-sectional area shall be 1. Calculated in accordance with regulation 543.1.3 for the most onerous of the values of fault current and operating time encountered in each of the various circuits, or 2. Selected in accordance with regulation 543.1.4 so as to correspond to the cross-sectional area of the largest line conductor of the circuits. So because we're using the second method of those two values, we'd need to use the largest line conductor in the conduit to check our conduit is okay. Now let's move on to regulation 543.1.4 to see how we're going to do this check. It states, where it is desired not to calculate the minimum cross-sectional area of a protective conductor in accordance with regulation 543.1.3, the cross-sectional area may be determined in accordance with table 54.7. This is the polite British standard way of saying, if you can't be bothered with the adiabatic equation, you can use this easier way. So why are there two different methods? Well, it's because while the adiabatic method is a bit more involved, it's also more specific, meaning that you could get away with using a smaller cross-sectional area for your CPC. It won't apply in this situation, but it could make a big difference if you're installing very large singles. The regulation concludes, where the application of table 54.7 produces a non-standard size, a conductor having a larger standard cross-sectional area shall be used. This is just saying that if after the process we're about to do, you end up with a weird number for your CPC, like 3.1 mil or something, then you can go to the next size up. So that would be 4 mil in that case. Okay, so let's look at table 54.7 as directed and see what it's telling us. In the first column, we've got the cross-sectional area of the line conductor in square millimetres. This value is given the identifying letter S. So if S, the size of your line conductor, is less than or equal to 16 mil, you'll use the top row. If it's bigger than 16 mil, up to and including 35 mil, you'll use the second row. And if it's bigger than 35 mil, you'll use the bottom row. The second and third columns are used to find what the size of our CPC must be. The second column doesn't apply to the situation as it's referring to a situation where your CPC is the same material as the line conductor. And in this case, of course, we're using steel conduit, not copper conduit. The third column is for when the protective conductor is of a different material to the line conductor, which is applicable in this situation. So just to make this a little more relevant, let's say we're feeding a socket outlet in 2.5 mil singles with 70 degrees C thermoplastic insulation, but we want to use the conduit as the CPC. Is that going to be acceptable? Well, our line conductor is smaller than 16 mil, so we'll be using the top row. Here we're instructed to use the formula K1 over K2 multiplied by S, and performing this calculation will tell us what the CSA of our conduit needs to be. So we know S is the CSA of our line conductor, so that'll be 2.5 in this case. But what about these K values? Well, in the regs, a K value is a factor that can be applied to calculations regarding fault current and the effects of the heat it generates in conductors. It's based on the resistivity, heat coefficient, and heat capacity of the conductor material in question. Beneath the table, we find out specifically what they are for in this calculation. K1 is the value of K for the line conductor selected from table 43.1 in chapter 43, according to the materials of both conductor and insulation. K2 is the value of K for the protective conductor selected from tables 54.2 to 54.6 as applicable. So let's find our value for K1 in table 43.1. You can see here we'll find our value in this column because we've got a thermoplastic insulated conductor rated at 70 degrees C smaller than 300 square millimetres. Because it's a copper conductor, we get a K value of 115. So that's our K1 value that we can put into our formula. But what about K2? Well, for this one, we've got a number of tables to consult, namely 54.2 to 54.6, but the one we're interested in is 54.5, which is values of K for steel conduit, ducting, and trunking as the protective conductor. Now, we'll use this column because the insulation is 70 degrees C thermoplastic, so our K value is 47, and putting that into the K2 slot of the formula, we now have the following calculation. 115 divided by 47 and then multiply the whole thing by 2.5, and this gives us an answer of 6.12. Now remember, that value of 6.12 is the minimum cross-sectional area that our CPC should have in square millimetres. So the next logical question is, what's the cross-sectional area of our conduit? Well, we can figure it out fairly easily. No doubt you remember how to find the area of a circle, which is simply pi times the radius squared. If we're using 20 mil conduit, it will have a radius of 10 mil, so that's pi times 10 squared, which gives us 314.16 square millimeters. Now that'd be great if the conduit was a solid cylinder, but it'd make it harder to get the cables in, so we need to subtract the area of the hollow section. Now what's the radius of the hollow section? Well, we could measure it, but it's better to consult the manufacturer's data in this case. MetPro state that for 20 and 25 mil steel conduit, the wall thickness is at least 1.37 millimeters. So subtracting that value from the 10 mil outer radius of the tube gives us 8.63 for the radius of the hollow section. So pi times 8.63 squared gives us 244.95 square millimeters. Subtracting the second value from the first will give us the area of the solid section, which is 69.21 square millimeters. So, can we use the steel conduit as the CPC? Well, we needed a minimum of 6.12 square millimeters from our calculation from table 54.7, and we got 69.21. So, yeah, should be okay. One final point to emphasise is found in 543.2.7, and it states that where the protective conductor is formed by metal conduit, trunking or ducting, or the metal sheath and or armour of a cable, the earthing terminal of each accessory shall be connected by a separate protective conductor to an earthing terminal incorporated in the associated box or other enclosure. So if you feed a socket outlet or a switch with conduit, you need to connect a fly lead from the earthing terminal in the socket or the switch to the earthing terminal in the back box to ensure that it's properly earthed. So there we go. You can indeed use steel conduit as the CPC for a circuit as long as you've met the requirements discussed in this video. But as always, we want to hear from you. Do you use steel conduit as a CPC, or do you always run a separate one in for good measure? Do you ever use the calculation from table 54.7 to check that your conduit CSA is acceptable? Whatever your thoughts, whatever your questions, please leave them in the comments section below. And as always, thank you very much for watching.